हेलो हेलो, माइक टेस्टिंग 1 2 3। స్క్రీన్ ముందర ప్యానల్ తో ఎవరెవరు ఉన్నారు?
Am I audible to everyone? Okay. So let us start our today's session. In the last class, we have started discussing about the Hadoop APIs for the MapReduce framework. And in the last class, we have discussed the classic MapReduce framework and as well as a little bit about Yarn MapReduce framework, which is the second version of Hadoop API. So let us continue the discussion of Yarn framework. My screen is visible to everyone. Is it visible or not? Okay. Right. In the last class, we have started discussing Yarn, which is the second version of Hadoop API. So Yarn stands for Yet Another Resource Negotiator. And the basic principle behind this is in the classic Hadoop API for the MapReduce framework, there the job tracker is the responsible for scheduling and assigning the tasks to the task managers, right? So if something went wrong with the job tracker, or if it gets failed, because it is also a software functionality, due to virus it may be corrupted, right? So whatever it may be the reason, whether it is technical reason or logical reason, if it gets failed, what is the position of the jobs that are currently running on it, and who will take care of supervising the running of the jobs? So it is a question mark in the classic MapReduce framework, because there is no other alternative. Nobody is there to look after the execution of the jobs which are currently running. Okay, so that is one aspect. And another aspect is whenever the scalability is the most important thing. Whenever if the size of your cluster gets increased, that means when you add number of systems to your clusters, when it passes the 4,000 nodes in a cluster, it becomes a difficulty task for the classic MapReduce framework to handle it. So that is the reason people have started developing an alternative to overcome the pitfalls that exist in the classic MapReduce framework. And in the year 2010, people have developed this Yarn, Yet Another Resource Negotiator. And from 2013 onwards, people are started using this particular framework, right? So how the Yarn will handle the failure in the job tracker is, here the job tracker responsibilities are divided into two domains. One is resource manager and another one is application master. So resource manager is responsible for arranging the resources required for the execution of the job, whereas application master in turn it is coordinating with the resource manager for the resources allocation and utilization of the resources, right? In simple terms, you can understand in another way is, whenever if a user submits a job, in the previous case, in the previous classic MapReduce framework, there we have discussed about how a user is going to be submit the job for the MapReduce framework, how it will be executed and all. So there, the job submitter instance will take care of the submission of the job process. There we have observed four different aspects. One is, initially it creates the job ID, and then it verifies the input path and output paths. Okay, and these are the responsibilities of job submitter instance during the submission of the job. Okay, it verifies the output path. Output path in the sense, when whatever the file name that you have specified, or whatever the location that you have specified to store the outputs, whether it is already exist or not. If it is already exist, simply it stops the execution of your job and return with an error message. So because what it assumes is, if it is already exist, means that is the location which is utilized by some other task or some other job is using it. So in that case, if it allowing you to overwrite the contents into that location, what happens? It is going to become an erroneous data for both the applications. Say for example, output.txt, which is used by some X application. Okay, so some X application was created that output.txt, where the X application wants to keep the outputs. Okay, at the same time, Y application specifies its output path as output.txt. In that case, suppose it allows you to store the outputs in that location, what happens? X application will store the outputs into the same output location, and Y application is also. So what happens in that case? Whatever the data that it contains, probably one record is stored by X application. Immediately, if you try to store something into it, what happens? The previous content will be overridden. The new record which you have entered, or which the Y application has entered, will be appeared over there. So it leads to erroneous data. So that is the reason. Always it looks for the uniqueness, right? So if it is already exist without verifying all these things, simply it responds with a error message, right? So similarly, the input path verification. Input path verification is why we need to verify the input path, because whatever the path that you have specified, in that path, if the input file is exist, then it is able to construct. It is able to construct the splits, means whatever the input file that you have supplied, by using that, it is going to be splitted into blocks, and those blocks in turn, it will be supplied to data nodes. So that is the process which is supposed to be going on. So instead of that, whatever the path that you have specified, where in that path, if there is no file exist with the name specified by you, then the entire process is going to be collapsed. Because here, the Hadoop framework, Hadoop itself will take care of everything, will be done automatically without any human intervention. So that is the reason they have developed this framework to take care of the things which will be automatically done. Okay, so that is the reason as a part of implementing automation, okay, if first of all it verifies this input paths and output paths, okay, and once everything is fine, now it copies the information, that is jar files, into the job tracker's location. You can assume that HDFS. Job tracker's location, you can assume that it is a HDFS. So all the information necessary for the execution of the job submitted by the user, not user, client, by the client, okay? So all the information will be copied into job tracker's file system. And then once the copying process is over, what the job tracker felt is, yes, now I have all the information. Now this is the time to share this task to various, to distribute this task to the various data nodes. So for that purpose, what initially it has to do? Task assignment. What it has to do? It need to verify whether what are the available resources, available data nodes which are active currently. So for that, what it does, it just polls it conducts the poll, and from that it is expecting heartbeat messages from the task trackers. Heartbeat messages from the task trackers. What it means? Yes, the task tracker is responding to the job tracker by passing a control message like, I am ready to receive the task. I am active as of now. Like that, it passes information to the job tracker. Then once it collects the information from all the task trackers, whatever the number of task trackers are required. How do you know how many number of task trackers are required? Say for example, if your file is divided into 10 blocks, then how many task trackers are required? We require 10 task trackers. If each and everyone is allocated to individual data nodes. So don't be confused. Here, the job tracker is running on name node. Name node consisting an important component called job tracker. Similarly, the data node will contains the important component called as task tracker. Both the job tracker and task tracker are the softwares. Okay, so once the block of data will be allocated by the job tracker to the data node, because the blocks are physically stored in data nodes, right? Once that process is done, immediately the task tracker will perform the operation on it. So these all the things need to be supplied by you means when you are writing a MapReduce program, you can observe it. So in the main function, that is driver code, where we can specify the configuration object, where we declare the configuration object with the class or with the job for which it is going to be executed. This contains the information regarding all the mapper classes, reducer classes, outputs, inputs, and the class names, everything. Okay, so the whole information is available with related to the job is available with this configuration object, right? And the name here, you can observe that file input format add input path, file output format dot set output path. Once this configuration object has defined, next step is it need to split the input into blocks. For that, it will verify it whether it is exist or not. If it is available, then what is the next step? It will be splitted into the blocks, and those blocks need to be distributed to data nodes, right? Those blocks need to be submitted to data nodes, and then the outputs are recorded in the output path specified here itself, along with the configuration object, right? And set mapper class. That means here you need to specify the class of the mapper logic. The class of the mapper logic is maximum temperature mapper dot class. So that is the class file which it was created after executing the Java. After compiling the Java, what it does? The Java compiler will create the max temperature mapper dot class. So which contains the object code which can be run on any other machines where the JVM is available. So here you can see that. So this is the name of the mapper class, max temperature mapper. This is the name of the class. As you know, after compiling the Java program, Java compiler will create a class file with the name that you have specified as a public class. Whatever the name that you have specified here itself, with this name, it creates the class file, public class max temperature mapper. So this is the class file created after executing this particular program, right? So, here what I mean to say is, here you can observe that these all the things we have specified the mapper class. So immediately what happens, this statement is going to be executed. This statement is going to be executed in the sense that particular job, that particular program is going to be executed here itself. What it does, it simply receives the inputs. Input as a key value pair, and it produces the intermediary output as a key value pair. Okay, and here the map method will accept these two, and here the reporter, it is an important aspect. As I told you while explaining this, we will discuss it later. So here the reporter is, which is used to know the progress of or status of your job execution. Okay, because sometimes it takes a lot of time for processing. For example, if you are dealing with image processing applications, sometimes it will take 1 week time to produce the outputs. Sometimes it may be 3 days, sometimes it may be 4 days. So during that period of time, it is continuously running, it is continuously analyzing the data. After 3 days or after 4 days, whatever the time it is requires, okay, it will produce the output. So in that case, you may have some curiosity, like you want to know what is the status of your job, whether it is executing or it is run, it is failed. So because nothing will be appeared on your screen, internally it is going to be run. So whenever if you want to know the status at a particular stages, we will use the this reporter object. With the help of this object, we can know the status or the progress of our execution. So this in both mapper method and the reducer method, we'll use this object to know the status, right? So that is the use of this reporter object, right? So here, whatever the code that you have specified in your map method, that will be executed. What it does, it simply captures the information from the input file that you have specified, where config file input format dot set input path. Okay, from that the input will be captured, and those input will be split into blocks, and those will be allocated to each and every data nodes, right? Say for example, in our case, assume that the input path which you have specified in your main program will be extracted, and it was divided into 10 blocks, and 10 blocks are assigned to 10 individual data nodes. Sometimes it may be happen two or three blocks of the same file may be allocated to single system. For better understanding, here we assume that the input file is split into 10 blocks. Those 10 blocks are assigned to 10 different data nodes, right? Whatever the process that we are specifying, that we are discussing right now, that means mapper logic, reducer logic, map reduce, this entire program execution will be taken care by task tracker, right? That means here the task tracker will start the execution from the main program driver code onwards. From it, it will be moved to the mapper logic and as well as reducer logic wherever you have specified, right? So here, whatever the output that you have specified, after executing the data, you may generate some intermediary output. So those output will be collected by output.collect method. Very soon we will discuss about what is the job of output collector, which we have specified here, okay? And what way it does, and what are the operations that it can perform, very soon we are going to be discussed. Until then, you just remember that whatever the local file system that exists in that location, these outputs will be, the collected outputs will be placed. Collected outputs are here, year and air temperature. So it is application specific. Here our application is, we want to find out the maximum temperature. So that is the reason here it will generate the key value pairs as year and the air temperature. Okay, suppose if you want to count the number of words which are present in the given file, then in that case, word become key and value will become how many number of times it was repeated, right? So it depends upon the application. These parameters may vary, but the process will be the same, right? So this mapper logic will generate the intermediary outputs. And another important point is that whatever the input format of this mapper logic may not be same as the output format. So here you can observe that input key value, these two specify the input key value, which is long writable. That means simply long. It is string data type. Okay. Here the key data type is long and value data type is string. At the same time, output, if you are observing, the key value is string data type and value is integer type. So this mapper logic will take long variables as a key and string as a value as an input, and it produces the output. The key type is string and the value type is integer. So what we observe from this is whatever the inputs that you have, whatever the formats that you have supplied as an input data may not be same as the output. Sometimes it may be same, even though they are not same, no issue. So that is what I mean to say, right? So this mapper logic is going to be executed, and after that, configure.setReducer class. So in this case, what happens? This reducer class is going to be whatever the method, because reducer, when it will be created, after executing the reducer method program, you will get the maximum temperature reducer class. Okay, this is going to be executed. And what it does, the reducer function is going to find out the maximum temperature in our case. And those will be, finally, it will write the outputs into the appropriate location that which you have specified in the output path. So mappers are producing intermediary results and they are stored in local file system. Okay, whereas the reducers will generate the outputs, will be placed at the path that you have specified. Okay, so finally we'll run the job. Okay, once these are all accepted, once these are all assigned automatically, just job client dot run the job config method. So which will take care of automatic execution of your MapReduce program. Now what you understood from this is job tracker, task tracker, data node, name node, these all internal frameworks. Whatever the code that you have written will apply on these components by utilizing the services that they are provided. Okay, so with the help of your MapReduce programming, you are able to coordinate name node, job tracker, data node, and task trackers to complete your application without any your instructions. Because here we will not give any instruction to the name node. You just do like a job tracker. You have to do this. The user will not pass any information, which will automatically done. So in such a way, you need to develop the code for it. So whatever the code that you have specified, which will work on it. Hope you all clear with this, because it is very essential to clear the basic. You are able to differentiate. You are able to differentiate the what exactly the name node, job tracker, data node, task tracker, and the relationship between MapReduce program and these components. How these components will help you while executing your MapReduce program. So these things are you are supposed to be very clear. So now, anybody is having any query? Are you clear with these aspects? Whatever I was discussing right now. Are you able to clear with this or not? Or any queries? Anybody, please. E2. Unmute yourself and you can talk. E2.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Are you able to differentiate the functionalities of job tracker and task tracker?
Yes, sir.
And you know the relationship between the MapReduce program and these components, building blocks of Hadoop?
Yes, sir.
Is it clear to you or not?
Clear, sir.
Okay, done. Any other one? Anybody else? Those who are having any queries? Because it is essential, because later we will discuss some elaborated or some advanced mechanisms. So if you are not clear with these things, what happens is it leads to confusion. So that is the reason why I'm asking a number of times. Don't think otherwise. You feel free to ask the queries. No hesitation. Anybody? Right. Okay. Now, so that is how a job is going to be executed, either in Hadoop 1.0 or Hadoop 2.0. The core functionalities are same, but the way which we do it is different, right? So in the previous case, the job tracker will take care of doing all the things. So now what happens is, the job tracker responsibilities, here also job tracker will be there. We did not change the name, but internally the job tracker is implemented with two different daemons. One is resource manager and another one is application master. So whenever if a job tracker receives any request from the client regarding the submission of the job, immediately it will redirect it to the resource manager. So what resource manager does, it will take care of verifying the input paths, creation of the job IDs, okay? And not like this, all these responsibility resources, it just try to inquire how many resources are active right now, like connecting the poll to the task trackers, how many of you are ready for receiving a new job, okay? So like that, it conducts a poll and based on the responses, it will calculate, it keeps some information with that. Okay, whenever if the job is submitted, automatically what it does, so based on the requirement of the resources required for that particular job will be allocated. So once immediately once this process is done, immediately application master, it passes information to the job tracker. Job tracker will pass information to the application master. Okay, your resources are ready, you go and collect it from the resource manager. So immediately application master will coordinating with the resource manager for accessing of the resources that are allocated for this particular job. Okay, at a time there are a number of programs are running, not only yours, because there are various data nodes are there. Okay, so many applications, concurrency, as we have discussed in the very beginning, it is possible to access the same by different applications, right? So that is the reason, whatever the resources that are allocated for you, you have the right, you in the sense here, application master. Okay, application master, just for application master, resource manager will pass information like, okay, these are the five systems you can use, system 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, these are the five systems you can use for the execution of your job. So application master will take care of the execution right from the beginning to the ending of the job by utilizing the five resources that was allocated. It does not have any right to access other than those five systems which are allocated for this particular job, even though the others are idle. Hope all of you clear it or not, right? So that is the idea, is that an application master negotiates. So this we have discussed the content. I think this part we have discussed. So initially we have submitted the job as the way in the classic MapReduce program. From there onwards the process will be changed. From the submit up to submission there is no issue. So once the job has submitted, now the resource manager will create the container. It creates the container which contains node manager and application master. Right, the process is same. That means process is same in the sense, client can submit the job to the job tracker. Job tracker in turn it will be allocated to the task trackers. The processes look like similar, but the way they did is different for the classic and this particular framework. Okay, so I think in the last class we have discussed what are the responsibilities of resource manager, node manager, and application manager. So node manager communicate with the resource manager. It runs on the slave nodes. Slave nodes in the sense data nodes. Master node in the sense name node. Okay, master slave JK flip flop you studied in DLD, right? So in the similar way here also it will function. It runs on the slave nodes of the cluster, and application master. There is one AM per application. So in the classic MapReduce, the task tracker will create one instance of task runner for each and every task. That means one person will be dedicated to this. You just take care of supervising all these things. Like that, it pass some information and it will allocate one person. So similarly, in a similar way, here also for each and every application, it creates an application master instance for it. Okay, so the AM runs on in containers that are created by the resource manager on request, right? So now you, as I told you, five resources are allocated for your application. Okay, five resources are allocated for your application means what? It means your input blocks are stored in these five systems. So now whatever the MapReduce program that you have developed, okay, that will be taken care by the task tracker. Okay, so here we are calling with a different name, application master. What it does is all these five systems which contains the input blocks on which whatever the MapReduce program that you have developed, that will be working with that data. Okay, so here that is the process. So containers in the sense, as I told you, immediately the node manager, whenever it starts the execution, node manager will create the containers where it contains all the resources information and all, those will be shared from the common area. It retrieves job resources, okay, and it creates yarn chain in the sense. So this is one application. For each and every application there will be a one application master, okay. So as the way it creates the task runner instance in the classic MapReduce framework, here also it creates yarn chain, okay. So with that it starts the execution of the map in a particular data node. So similarly in this way all other data nodes are also be added to this, and those will be execute in the similar fashion, okay. Now let us see the same steps whatever we have discussed in the classic MapReduce program, classic MapReduce paradigm framework. So in the similar way how it will be done with the yarn also we will see. Job submission, jobs are submitted in MapReduce 2 using the same API as MapReduce 1. That means whatever the way that classic MapReduce framework allows you to submit the job, here also the same. And Map 2 has an implementation of client protocol that is activated when MapReduce framework name is set to yarn. So very soon we will discuss about this. Until then you just remember that once you activated the MapReduce framework dot name is set to yarn, so automatically this client protocol is going to be executed. So the submission process is very similar to the classic implementation. The new job ID is retrieved from the resource manager rather than job tracker. There the resource manager will allocate the job IDs, whereas here in the classic the job tracker will allocate the job IDs, whereas in the MapReduce 2 the resource manager will allocate the job IDs. Now job initialization, when a resource manager receives a call to its submit application, right, it hands off the request to the scheduler. The scheduler allocates a container and the resource manager then launches the application master process there under the nodes manager's management. So you can see the diagram 5a 5b. Once the application is submitted, immediately the resource manager will allocate will create a containers. It contains node manager and application master, okay. Start container, launch the application master, okay. And then the application master initializes the job by creating a number of bookkeeping objects to the keep track of the job's progress, as it will receive progress and completion reports from the tasks, okay. And next it retrieves the input splits computed in the client from the shared file system. It then creates the map task object for each split and the number of reduced task objects determined by the MapReduce job reduces property. So now what happens is after creation of the containers, okay, so application master will start its working what it does is, so it just simply whatever the number of sub task runners are required, it creates that much of, because the whole application it will be created one application master will be allocated, okay. So who will take care of all the process as the task tracker, as the way the task tracker creates the task runner instance, here also it creates the yarn child, okay. So here whatever the number of yarn childs are required, how do you know how many number of yarn childs are required? It depends upon the input blocks where they were stored, okay. So depends upon that it going to be allocate creates the yarn child, and then it retrieves the information for the processing from the shared file system. Finally it produces the output, right, and it creates the number of map task objects and reducer task objects. So that also we need to be clear how many number of mob tasks are essential to execute a job, and similarly how many reducer jobs are required to execute the job. These things we will elaborately discuss later. Now let us look at about the differences that exist among the two frameworks, right? So Hadoop provides two Java MapReduce APIs named as old and new respectively, like you can imagine classic and AR. So the first difference is the new API favors abstract classes over interfaces. In the classic, everything will be MapReduce based and all acts as an interfaces. Whereas here, there will be abstract classes. What is the difference between interface and the abstract class? You all aware of it, right? You have very good experience with the object-oriented programming paradigm, right? Since this is easier to evolve, for example, you can add a method with a default implementation to an abstract class without breaking old implementation of the class, right? Without breaking old implementation of the class. So, for example, the mapper and reducer interfaces in the old API are abstract classes in the new API. Now they will become abstract classes in the, because previously we need to be implements, because they are the interfaces. There we have writing the name implements, map reduce base implemented by mapper logic, like that we are supposed to write the code. But here it will be an abstract methods. So with this, what we can do is we can create our own definition without disturbing the previous one. The new API in the org.apache.hadoop.mapreduce package and sub-packages, the old API can still be found on. Right. So they are available in these two. There is no difference in it. Only just this package name we need to be specified. And the new API makes extensive use of context objects that allow the user code to communicate with the MapReduce system. So based on the contexts, we can create the objects for those contexts, and those contexts are used to communicate with your MapReduce framework. So the new context, for example, essentially unifies the role of job config, the output collector, and the reporter from the old API. Now we can see a different look or different way how this job configuration object and output collectors will be used in new API. We will see in the example programs how they are different with the old APIs, right? So in both APIs, key value record pairs are pushed to the mapper and as well as reducer. But in addition, the new API allows both mappers and reducers to control the execution flow by overriding the run method. Okay, here we'll have an additional method. With that, we will try to control the mapper and execution of the execution flow of the mapper logic and the reducer logic. In the old API, it is possible, this is possible for mappers by writing map runnable method. Of course, we did not see much more examples on old API. So that is the reason you are not able to differentiate the old API and the new API. But these are the, some of the points you just remember. Very soon, when we are entering into the college, we will try to execute the programs in old API and as well as new API, so that you are able to understand the difference that exists among the codes and the facilities that are provided in the new APIs. Until then, you just remember these points. Configuration has been unified. The old API has a special job conf object for the job configuration. In the new API, the distinction is dropped. So the job configuration is done through the just simply a configuration object. There is no separate files for the job and ordinary configuration. Here, everything will be under the supervision of configuration object, right? And job control is performed through the job class in the new API rather than old job client, which is no longer exist in the new API. So in the old API, we are supposed to use old job client for controlling the job information, but here we'll have job class. So the output files are named slightly different. In the old API, map and reduce outputs are named part slash num, as I show you the output. Here you can observe that the output. Cat output slash part 000. So this is possible in the old API. A part of the output you can view in the old API by using the output command in this fashion. But now, while the new API, the map outputs are named underscore only this, and the reduce outputs are named part r slash these four ends. Map outputs are available in the same fashion as the way old output, but for the reducer it is going to be a little bit different. Is an integer designation a part number? Okay, as I told you, during the execution of your program, sometimes you want to know the progress and all. So in order to check how much a part of your code is being executed, will be known with the help of this part outputs. Okay, and of course it will be done with the help of reporter object. So these things will help you to know the execution of your program. In the new API, the reduce method passes values as java.lang.iterable rather than java.lang.iterator. You know the difference between iterable and iterators, right? And this change makes it easier to iterate over a value using Java's for each loop constructor for. Okay, so these are the some of the differences that exist among the old API and the new API. Don't worry, we will have a very good we'll try to gain some experience with these two in very soon, whenever we start execution of programs in the laboratories. So until then, you may not recognize the importance of these two differences, right? So that is about the difference between old and new APIs. Okay, so don't worry, I'll share this complete document to you. I forgot it to forward yesterday, but today I'll do it. Okay, and now before going to discuss about the other components, other parts of our syllabus, one should understand thoroughly. My screen is visible to you? Is it visible to you? Is it visible to you? Okay. There. So before going to discuss much more about this map reduce and all, you might have a lot of queries in your brain, like the total MapReduce code which we have observed for the maximum temperature or very soon for the word count and all, you might have a doubt because you don't know anything about these classes which are used. Sometimes we are using interfaces, sometimes we are using classes. Okay, so you have to know what exactly the use of these classes and interfaces, how they will be used in writing the MapReduce program. So these things I just want to make you people very clear so that it will help you to develop the programs in future with your own. So actually, if it is not part of your syllabus, but I just want to enhance yourself by giving complete information regarding the classes and all which are supposed to be used in the MapReduce program. So in the first, we will look at about the functionality of the mapper, right? So as you all aware of that, what is the job of this mapper logic? Mapper logic will accept the inputs as key value pairs and it produces the intermediary key value pairs as an output, right? Maps are the individual tasks that transform input records into intermediary records, right? The transformed intermediate records do not need not be of the same type. Okay, And finally, a map may produce, a mapper logic may produce either zero or more key value output pairs. Okay. So the Hadoop MapReduce framework spans on map task for each input split generated by the input format for the job. Okay. So here what it does is whatever the input split that is present in the data node on which this mapper logic is going to be executed, as you all aware of that. Right. Now let us see, these are the some of the mechanisms that are used in a mapper logic. Overall mapper implementation are passed to the job config for the job via job configurable dot configure dot of job config method. So you just see what is the use of this method. Okay, it is an interface. Job configurable is an interface. So it contains the method void configure job conf of job. It initializes the new instance from the job for the this particular object. Just it creates the object for this job configuration. Okay, and you can see how it will be. So this is the definition. The parameters for this is the job configuration. Okay, and now so with that we can create the job configuration object, and then we will write the map method. Map writable comparable writable output collector reporter. So this is the syntax of the mapper logic. So map logic contains, map method contains the parameters are input, output, and reporter. So these types which you are supposed to be specified. So what it does is, so here I was mentioned, I was clearly write the code for each and every one. So in the next class we will see elaborately how this, what is the job of this output collector, as I told you in the previous slides. Okay, so what is the job of this output collector and what is the job of these two, why we need to be specify all these things here in the map class, and what exactly the closable dot close method, what it does, these things. And that means what I mean to share you is all the functionalities, all the functionalities in the sense except the logic, except the logic. Logic is purely your application dependent. Okay, but whatever the way which you are supposed to be define the mapper logic, and whatever the parameters that it need to have, and whatever the methods or objects that you can create in the mapper logic as well as the reducer logic, along with the description of the of its functionality, we will discuss elaborately in the next class. Right. So hope you all are clear with these concepts. You please let me know if any queries are there. Any queries? Do you have any queries? So today's class absents are A1, C2, C6, C7, D4, D7, E7, F6, G2, G3, G6, H3, H7, and I2. Because a lot of people need to join, so many people are absent today. You just pass the information to them, make sure that they will attend the classes regularly so that they are unable to understand. If they miss a particular class, okay, it is very difficult for them to understand the next topic. Okay. Okay, any queries? If no queries, we'll wind up the session because another session need to start. Okay, so in the next class, we will see the remaining part of the mapper classes and as well as the reducer classes. Okay, now I will end the session. Thank you.